speaker is Gabe Musso, co-founder and chief scientific officer at Biosymmetrics Incorporation. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thanks for the introduction. So I want to talk to you about how we are accelerating timelines for drug discovery, for phenotype-based drug discovery in vivo. For this project, we wanted to start with pediatric epilepsy. And for that, we started to work with our knowledge graph. So our knowledge graph, which we call the phenograph, is an association of linkages between human genes, human diseases, and human phenotypes phenotype terms, and corresponding genes and phenotypes in model systems, primarily zebrafish. So for our zebrafish models, we've got over 300 individually trained machine learning models that predict the effect of thousands of genes on each of those individual phenotypes. And just to give you a sense of how that looks, in this little video, we're going to start to search for, in this case, pediatric epilepsy. And we're going to start to put in some of the phenotypes that we're particularly interested in, some neural phenotypes that are relevant in our model system. And what's going to happen is we're going to generate an aggregate score for each of these model system phenotypes. So this plot that's generated on the lower left here, this is every dot on this plot is an individual gene. And the height that you are on the y-axis is the strength of association of that gene with the input human human disease. The extent you are to the right is the strength of the prediction that that gene will cause any of those input phenotypes. And so we're looking at specificity of those phenotypes. And through this process, we like to identify genes that are in this upper right. So genes that have both a high level of human association with the disease, in this case, epilepsy, and genes that have a strong prediction of manifesting a phenotype. So we're effectively looking for causality on the basis of predicting a phenotype in our model system. And that led us to a gene called KCC2. And KCC2 has been associated with pediatric epilepsy and other types of neurological disorders. We made both a genetic and a CRISPR model in embryonic zebrafish. For anyone that's not seen zebrafish before, they're a transparent model organism. And what we've basically developed is a high content in vivo system for imaging zebrafish. So we can automatically identify different morphological and behavioral characteristics simultaneously. We can build out a rich barcode of phenotypes that we can then associate to very specific genetic and small molecule effects. And when we look at this particular gene, so what we've got is we've got zebrafish that have the mutation on the right that we introduced using CRISPR and control zebrafish on the left. And we're just going to turn on a strobe light. And you can see when that happens, they tend to scatter a lot more on the right. This is something we see both in the genetic and chemical inhibition model for this gene. It's very specific to these particular frequencies of light. So it's very much mimicking things you would see in a human stimulus-derived epilepsy. So leveraging this, we started to screen out thousands of different small molecules. We prioritized chemical space using machine learning models that were designed to predict phenotypic effects. And we started to screen those small molecules. So this is just an activity readout of our phenotype. And this underneath it is a UMAP plot. Every dot on this particular plot is an individual compound that had been screened in this epilepsy model. What you're seeing here, so these red dots are positive controls, so phenytoin, which is a clinically used anti-epileptic compound, but is also a sedative. And so it has a very kind of specific sedative effect. These yellows and blue dots, those are our control compounds. So those are effectively, you know, wild type. And what we're looking for is we're looking for purples that kind of have the same pattern of the wild type. So kind of are less sedating and more actively addressing the disease mechanism. And those are exactly the compounds that we progressed. So through rescreening, dose response analysis, and toxicity analysis, we ultimately whittled this down to a set of three compounds that were progressing. We now have again used machine learning to predict mechanism. They all appear to be novel first-in-class compounds. And we're getting these into rodent models within the next few weeks. So over a course of months, we went from, hey, we should look at pediatric epilepsy to having compounds with in vivo efficacy, with nice dose response ranges, with no signs of apparent toxicity in vivo, and with penetrance of the blood-brain barrier as measured in zebrafish. Really the biggest bottleneck there in that kind of 3 or 4 months long process was waiting for chemical resynthesis. And so certainly some areas for optimization there. But we clearly feel that this is a process that can be repeated across very neurological and cardiovascular disorders. Thank you. Looking forward to discussing this at my poster.
Thanks, Gabe.